June 1999, the year I was born, marked 8 years since Uzbekistan became an independent republic. Till nowadays, traces of the Soviet Union are strongly imprinted on people's faces, minds and fences. I never thought about ideas that stand behind that time. I never knew the difference. After spending some time abroad, I came back to my home country and started to see how special those traces are. It led me to a thought. What exactly could provoke anyone to build anything like that? The celebration of beliefs was carved into a rock, the proudness of achievements thrown into iron shapes and forms. I didn't feel the pain or glory of those people, but something inside of me had changed. That's how monumental architecture turned into a very special journey for me. My graduation project, Conversations Through Time, questions the main purpose of monumentalism by asking, can we perceive monumental architecture, both Soviet and classical, without seeing it as part of a propaganda machine? Volume 1. Ingredients of Conversation Through Time. As time went by, the appearance of primitive architecture began to change. People started to put their visions and ideas into it by applying symbols and details that support common beliefs and traditions. The rise of the Roman Empire shaped a new vision for its society. Places of power, justice, and nationhood, such as temples, courts, and palaces, became its clear representation. The ideas and functions of these buildings are easily distinguished. Monumental architecture guided and communicated with settlers. It gave a feeling of a higher idea, a purpose. During my recent visit to Paris, my first destination was Pantheon. I discovered the typology of monumental constructions. What are specific features and elements? Hundreds of years, religion served as a moral compass for humankind. Before we entered the 20th century, the wind of change swept away old ideas.
The new era had begun.
Modernism. If you got to open a toolbox named How to Rule the World, be sure you will find propaganda in there. Within a couple of years, a few people managed to cancel religion and turn atheism into one of the pillars of a new ideology – communism. But communism wasn't the only ideology that was actively using propaganda. On the other hand, there was Nazism. Guck uns an, sieh nur, was aus uns geworden ist. Fühlt sich an, als wenn der Junge mitten im Mitt gestorben ist. Nie wieder Teledin, denn ich hab aufgehört. Hab was mit deinem Schritt, mein Traum zerstört. Stalinist and Hitlerite architecture have a lot in common. Both leaders, Stalin and Hitler, represented totalitarian architecture. Both were dreaming of a perfect society. Gigantic, brutal, dominant, and belligerent architecture became a reflection of both regimes and their ideologies. A visual confirmation of communist and Nazi ideologies found its comfort in monumental architecture. Volume 2. Back then, buildings spoke for themselves. Their architecture informed us about its function or purpose. How? Shapes, forms, details, complex, long-lasting elements. And today, faceless building. You can never tell what's going on inside. So they can host more than 1,000 functions and appearances at once. Faceless buildings put on ideologies like a new outfit. It's nothing but everything at once, wearing billboards as armor. Propaganda doesn't make permanent architectural changes anymore. It's live on screen, like a flashlight. Volume 3. inspired by a monumental building that hosts massive events such as the Met Gala at the Metropolitan Museum, top-list concerts at Verona Arena, and sports events at Madison Square Garden. The goal of my journey is to discover the way monumental architecture would look like in the postmodernist environment of the 21st century. That's how I decided to create an ideology-free event space. Nowadays, people have a variety of beliefs and our idols live in a digital world, and we don't share one common ideology, as it was before. Captured by a paradox of choice, we think we don't kneel to any ideas anymore. The building itself has prepared two main experiences for visitors. Experience A. The heart of the building invites visitors to come in. A huge digital screen is placed in its center under the floor. The lights press through a narrow hall. Once people come in, it will attract their curiosity, so they will eventually bend down to peek at this hall. They will see live streams from all over the world.
We are concerned about trouble and trying to be responsible. One-sided news stories.
Which literally will make them kneel to ideas shared online.
Come here. Kneel.
The second experience is prepared for the upper floor visitors. Once they reach the first floor by using stairs in the main hall, the visitors will find a huge panoramic view that exhibits events of the core. By observing people who are captured by the digital screen below, visitors of the upper floor will try two roles. On one hand, they will become those silent stalkers who are watching other people's lives on the internet. On the other hand, they will try the role of gods by elevating among others and watching at people from above.
And you, Hades, will rule all!
Yes, Hades will!
A word of caution to this tale.
Wait. Let's come down to Earth. And let's take a closer look at floor plans. During this journey, I reflected on different aspects of monumentalism and implemented them into my personal vision.
If you come closer, if you open your eyes, you can hear those silent conversations through time.
Watching people from above.